بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
يا حبيبي يا رسولي يا حبيبي يا رسول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الهادين المهديين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي. يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد أفضل صلواتك وعدد معلوماتك وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. دع ما ادعته النصارى في نبيهم، واحكم بما شئت مدحا فيه واحتكمي. وكيف يدرك في الدنيا حقيقته قوم نيام تسلوا عنه بالحلم. يا رب بالمصطفى بلغ مقاصدنا واغفر لنا ما مضى يا واسع الكرم. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who gathered us here to rectify ourselves and gathered us here to talk and to remember Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and after sending countless and endless salutations upon Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, the one who we have come to remember and we have come to talk about and come to take on his beautiful attributes. We have come to talk about his beautiful attributes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted him and has given to him and has made him the bearer of them attributes. Now, when it comes to talking about Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, we should know that many pious individuals, many pious awliya, many pious scholars of Islam, the rasikhun fil ilm, those who were strong in their knowledge, have written endless and endless volumes and books and books, many books on the life of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now, the life of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is endless, and the scholars' pens, the scholars' words, If it be that scholars write their books in the highest eloquence, in the highest language, whichever language they have chosen to write about Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, then the ink can run out, but the life of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and what they need to write about it, they cannot write it. Papers will end, trees will finish, leaves will be scarce, but the life of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam will never be put onto paper fully. Now this is just regarding the life of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. But then there are other scholars, because the life of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, if you look at the seerah books, doesn't concentrate upon the normal life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it concentrates around the events that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was put through and the trials and tribulations that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was put through. The certain events that happened in Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam's life, seerah concentrates upon them. But then there were many scholars that didn't talk about the events or the seerah that concentrated on special events in the life of Rasulullah, but the normal life of Rasulullah. What was special in Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam's life on his normal day? What was special with Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, the way he talked? What was special with Rasulullah, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only gave to Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam? This is where a book like Khasais al-Kubra, Imam Suyuti's Khasais al-Kubra comes in, where they only talked upon the specialities of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. It's still a seerah book. It talks about Rasulullah, how Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam walked, what the miracles of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam were, how Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam ate, how Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was with the people. He did not like himself. Like it comes when Abu Sufyan came to accept Islam, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam put out his shawl for him. But yes, Abu Sufyan at that time was the arch enemy of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. How Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam used to meet others, how his dealings were with other people. Now this is the beautiful characteristics of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ahzab verse 21, he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned and states clearly that for you in Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is what? Uswatun hasana. There is a beautiful example, there are beautiful characteristics inside Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. For whom? For us. Lakum. For us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly states this. And he further says that these examples are for those people who have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who hope that they will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of reckoning. They hope on the day of judgment that they will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His mercy. They will see the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which will have mercy upon it, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be showing them mercy, and they will not see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His anger. Like the kuffar will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His anger. But this uswa hasana, these beautiful examples, the beautiful characteristics of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala, this is what we're going to be concentrating for today. And this is the part of the life of Rasulullah ta'ala we are going to be concentrating on today. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put these beautiful examples, the beautiful characteristics inside Rasulullah that we can take aboard, that we can do the tahalluq of. What does tahalluq mean? Tahalluq means that we can take these characteristics aboard and make them ourselves. Like for example, the tahalluq of sabr. Rasulullah ta'ala had patience inside him. Rasulullah ta'ala was rahim. He had mercy inside him. Now, to do the takhalluq and to take these characteristics aboard, this is what we need to learn. This is the part of the life of Rasulullah ta'ala wa sallam we can act upon by taking on his attributes. Now, for some people, these attributes come naturally. There'll be patience inside some people. Naturally, they'll be patient with everything around them. People will say anything to them and they will be patient. But then there are some who cannot be patient. Now, for them, they have to take it on a board with difficulty, if it has to be, to take this quality of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that in Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam for you is uswatun hasana. That is a beautiful example. But let it be known right now that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam himself is beauty. Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is the origin of beauty. Beauty originates from Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now, if you want beauty, then you have to go to Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now, to take this beauty in, we have many books. And one of those books was written by Qazi Ayaz. He lived in Morocco most of his life and he was buried there. Now, he was a scholar of his time. He was the muhaddis of his time. He was the hafiz of his time. Not just a hafiz, he knew the Quran really well. To an extent that if you asked him a verse of the Quran, he would straight away pinpoint on where it is in the Quran. But not just that, he was a master in the Sab'a Qira'a, the Sab'a Ahruf, the seven dialects of the Quran, he was a master in them. He was the only one in his time who was a master in the Sab'a Ahruf. In the seven dialects of the Quran, he was the only one. He was the muhaddis of his time. He was the usuli. He specialized in the Maliki fiqh. Now he was the usuli of his time. He was the mutakallim of his time. But the best work he did that we want and which can help us is Ash-Shifa. Ash-Shifa, which he wrote in the khasais of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, in the specialities of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, in talking about Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, the way he walked, the way his physical appearance was, and this is what the core of the book is about, the physical appearance of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because he describes Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam inside it. Now Qazi Ayaz, he was born in 476 Hijri. And coincidentally, he was born on the 15th of Sha'ban. He was born on the night of 15th of Sha'ban, coincidentally, which is tonight, Saturday night. And alhamdulillah, we got the chance of reading his book on his birthday. Now Qazi Ayaz, he was born on 476 on the 15th of Sha'ban, and he passed away on 544 Hijri in Jamadul Akhir. Now, which makes him roughly about 64 years of age. But in 64 years, he had done a lot of work for Islam. Until this day, he's buried in Morocco. Now, he was a man who knew the Asma'ul Rijal, the biographies of all the companions, all the Tabi'in, and any person that narrated the hadith of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now, the book, as I keep mentioning, is Ash-Shifa. Now, something about Ash-Shifa was that he physically describes Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And Imam Allahi, if memory serves me right, he says that once I got ill, I was severely ill, and in front of me was Ash-Shifa. I had it in front of me and I decided to read it. And I started reading it, and I read from cover to cover, from one end to the other end. And he says, I raised my hands towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I said, oh Allah, for the sake of this book, which describes Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, describes the attributes of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, for the sake of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and this book, take my illness away. And you know what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed his illness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieved him of this illness through the blessings of Ash-Shifa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him shifa through Ash-Shifa. This is why one of the reasons it is called Ash-Shifa. Now, the part we are going to concentrate on, what we in the Islahi Majalis want to concentrate on, is rectifying ourselves. And the part I've chose, couple of parts and couple of chapters from Ash-Shifa. The first part, concentrating with the tawazu of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, the humbleness of Rasulullah, and the modesty of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second part will be the khawf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, being the closest and the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to make happy all the time, being the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends mercy upon all the time, how Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam still feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How he would do things to make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala happy. And how he would make praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the nights. And how we'd fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third part, if I have time, would be the part concentrating on the zuhud of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The zuhud, how Rasulullah ta'ala detached him from this world. How he detached himself from this world. How he would take himself away and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Something we need to do living in this country. We are being sucked in by this country and this world more and more and more, and chasing the world that we forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We forget to take out time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Primarily the reason why this Islahi Majalis exists for today. That we come here for 3 days or 4 days or through the weekend so that we can only give ourselves time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where we get rid of all the things that we have in our minds and the worldly things, and just to concentrate on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now I'll go straight into the book in which Qazi Iyaz firstly says that even though Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam amma tawazu ala uluv mansibihi, that even though Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam had the highest ranks, he was on the highest ranks of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. But regardless, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was still humble. He says, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was the most strongest in his humbleness and his modesty for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He states a hadith that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was the least of pride. He didn't have takabur inside him. He didn't have pride inside him. Whenever somebody came to meet him, he would be humble with them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He would never show his pride. He didn't even have a single speck of pride inside him. When somebody came, even being the king of this universe, being the leader and the master of this universe, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam never showed that. He was always humble with the people that came to him. In a hadith, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam says, and Qazi Iyaz says, that for you to understand the humbleness of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, then this thing is sufficient for you. What? That Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was given the choice of being a Nabi and Malik, being a prophet and being a king, being a prophet king, if you like to say. That a prophet who is also a king, like Hazrat Sulaiman. He lived his life as a prophet, but as a king, being the leader of everything, having control of the jinn, of the shayateen, having control of the winds and the birds, knowing the language of the birds, knowing the language of the animals and the ants, knowing the language of every single creation, having control of the winds. When he wants something, the winds bring it to him. Having control of the jinns, when he wants a throne of certain people, the jinns bring it to him. He lived like a king. Whatever he wanted, it was in front of him. Rasulullah ta'ala was given a choice to live a life like Sulaiman alayhi salam. But then he was given a choice of being a Nabiyan Abdan, being a thankful slave, being a special slave, and being a prophet who is a slave who is thankful to his Lord. And you know what Rasulullah ta'ala wasallam chose? فَخْتَارَ أَنْ يَكُونَ نَبِيًّا عَبْدًا. That Rasulullah ta'ala wasallam chose to be a thankful slave and a prophet. He didn't have to be a thankful slave, but he chose to live that life to show his modesty and his humbleness towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him this choice to come forward and live like a king. And as you'll see further, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on many occasions gave Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam many things, but Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam denied them. Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam chose a life of humbleness and modesty. Further on, it is said that Israfil, at this point when Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was given this choice, Israfil alayhi salam said, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَعْتَاكَ بِمَا تَوَادَعْتَ لَهُ أَنَّكَ. He says that indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you in abundance. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in exchange of your humbleness, will raise your ranks to what you cannot think. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you be humble towards him, he will give you things and gift you things. But yet, one thing he has given in exchange of that. And what is that? أَنَّكَ سَيِّدُ وُلْدِ آدَمْ. That you are the leader of the offspring of Adam. On the day of judgment, يوم القيامة, on the day of judgment, you will be the leader of the offspring of Adam. Now don't get confused. It seems that we are taking Hazrat Adam out, but there are many messengers in, for example, the Ulul Azam messengers like Hazrat Ibrahim, who are higher in rank than Hazrat Adam. And Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is higher than them. He is the leader of Hazrat Ibrahim on the Day of Judgment, which includes that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam on the Day of Judgment will also be the leader of Hazrat Adam. Now this was the rank of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And understand this, that he is the leader and the master and the one who will hold the liwa'ul hamd, the flag of praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment, something that no other prophet in his life or in his dreams could ever think of holding. This is such a rank which Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is the sole owner of. He is the owner of the liwa'ul hamd. He is the owner of Maqami Mahmood. Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is the interceder for us on the Day of Judgment. Now when Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, look at the humbleness of Rasulullah. The companions narrate that once Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, kharaja alayna Rasulullah, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam came out upon us. He came towards us, mutawakki'an ala asa. He was leaning upon his stick. It was the days that he was ill. He was leaning upon his stick. Faqumna lahu. And we all stood up for him. Just like what we do for the scholars today. The companions say, we all stood up for him. And what happens? Then Rasulullah says, La taqumu kama taqumu al-ajimu. Do not stand up like the foreigners stand. The ajim, anyone who's non-Arabic, non-Arab. Any other country who is not an Arabic country, they are called the ajim, the foreigners. Rasulullah ta'ala sallam said, he refers to the Persians, that do not stand like the foreigners stand for the kings. Yu'azimu ba'zuha ba'zan, that some of them praise and gratitude others by standing up. Now we should know that standing up is roughly on four types. Standing up for a scholar or for someone who hates and dislikes and holds it to be disrespect for him to stand up for him. In this case, it'll be haram to stand up for him. When he tells you to sit down, you sit down for him. The second is disliked. A person who holds it permissible for you to stand up for him, but then he dislikes it that you stand up for him and he tells you to be seated. For you in that time, it's just to sit down. It is disliked to stand up for him. The third is a scholar who just holds it permissible, regardless if you stand up for him or not. He says it's okay. For you to stand up at this time is permissible. And this is what most of the scholars in this day and age are upon. And the third and the best one is to stand up for a person who has just come back from his travels. Why? Because this has a nas upon it. This comes through the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whereas the rest just come from us respecting and taking them out of the hadith of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, but this one has specifically been stated by Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, that you stand up for that person who comes back from his travels. Now this is the humbleness of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, that he wouldn't like, even though being the king of the universe, having the whole world in his command, having the skies and the mountains and the earth in his command, if he wanted, he could have it all. But Rasulullah ta'ala chose to be humble. And he chose that the companion should not stand up for him. Out of humbleness, this is not a nahi from Rasulullah ta'ala that you cannot do this forever and ever. But rather it's just to teach the companions humbleness. That when they go to teach the tabi'een, for example, that they do not get this pride in themselves that we used to stand for Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam never told us off, so I expect my students to stand up for me. Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was teaching them humbleness. Regardless if someone stands up for you or not, you be humble to yourself and towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In another hadith, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّمَا أَنَا عَبْدٌ أَكُلُ كَمَا يَأْكُلُ الْعَبْدُ, that I am a slave who eats just like any other slave who eats. I am a slave and a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I eat like any other person. He further says, wa ajlisu kama yajlisu al-abd, and I sit like any other person sits. This is the humbleness of Rasulullah. He's Rasulullah. He's the messenger of Allah. Such a rank that nobody in this day and age can ever get. There is no prophet coming after him. He's Khatamun Nabiyyin. Understand these ranks. We say, you probably hear from the scholars often and more often and often, where to us they become meaningless. But understand them when we say he's Khatamun Nabiyyin, that there is no prophet after him. Nobody can ever gain the status in their life ever. But look, he is saying, Innama ana abdun, that I am a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Aqlu, I eat just like any other slave. And I sit like any other slave. But now let's look at how Rasulullah ta'ala sallam used to eat. Rasulullah ta'ala sallam sometimes used to sit on all fours, used to cross his legs and sit down. Just the way the brother sat here right now, he used to sit like that and eat. He used to sit like that in a gathering. Rasulullah ta'ala sallam, when he used to come to just sitting down or come to eating, he used to raise his left leg, his left knee, and raise it up like this and sit and eat like this. When Rasulullah ta'ala sallam, and you normally even just not even eating but just sitting, Rasulullah ta'ala sallam used to sit like this. Rasulullah ta'ala sallam was so humble with his companions that when he used to enter, even if there was space at the back, Rasulullah ta'ala sallam used to sit at the back. He never used to walk at the front, trampling all the people. But he used to sit where even if it was at the shoes, Rasulullah ta'ala used to sit there. Until someone realized, some of the companions realized that Rasulullah ta'ala was sat there. Rasulullah ta'ala used to mix in with his companions in such a way that if an outsider came in to meet Rasulullah ta'ala, he would not recognize Rasulullah. Because Rasulullah ta'ala dressed like his companions and he would sit in and amongst his companion in such a way that the foreigner could not even tell which was Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam would sit with his both knees up and fasten his arms accordingly, like this, fasten his arms. And sometimes if he had an imam ashrif or his cloth, he would get it off and fasten it around so his arms would not get tired. And he would just sit like this with the cloth around him. This is the utmost state of humbleness. Humbleness towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That he's showing, I am weak, O Allah. I have nothing. I have nothing. All I have is from you. And anything that you give me is from you. I am humble. Forgive my nation. That used to be the dua of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam all the time. Now this is how humble Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was. I'm running out of time, but we can go into the humbleness of Rasulullah and the examples of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. One example is Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, La tutruni, that do not exaggerate in my praise. What? Kama atratin nasara, do not exaggerate in my praise like the Christians exaggerated with the son of Maryam. Do not exaggerate like that. What? By calling me the son of God, or by calling me God. Innama ana abdun, But indeed I am a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Faqulu Abdullah. So call me by the name Abdullah and call me by the name of Rasulullah. Now look at the state. Rasulullah ta'ala sallam being the leader of the messengers, being the leader of the Anbiya, being the Imam of the Anbiya. He's saying that I am just a slave. Call me an Abd. Call me just a slave. Call me just a messenger like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in the Quran. Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam has not stated that you should not praise him. And Imam Busiri puts this clearly. He says, دَعْمَدَّعَتْهُ النَّصَارَ فِي نَبِيِّهِمِ, that leave that what the Christians proclaimed and claimed about Isa alayhi salam. Leave that. What? Do not call him God. And do not call him the son of God. And do not do shirk of Rasulullah ta'ala sallam with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what do they say? Wahkum bima shi'ta. He says, command and praise Rasulullah ta'ala sallam after not calling him the son of God and not calling him God. After this, praise him with whatever you like. Madham fihi wahtakimi. Praise him with whatever you like. With whatever words that you can bring on your tongue in the highest eloquence for Rasulullah ta'ala sallam, that is insufficient. It cannot reach the rank of Rasulullah ta'ala sallam. In whatever language you put it in, it will not reach the status of Rasulullah. It cannot even come close to praising Rasulullah ta'ala sallam. But do not just call him God. Imam Busiri clearly states that La Tutruni does not mean that we cannot praise Rasulullah. It just means that do not praise him by calling him God. And do not praise him by calling him the Son of God. Do not do shirk with Rasulullah. Now if you go further, Rasulullah, there are many examples of the humbleness of Rasulullah. But I'm going to skip straight to the zuhud of Rasulullah. In what Rasulullah, how he used to detach himself from this world and how he used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, it is narrated that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam did not spend two continuous days by eating chapatis made of barley or wheat. Imagine that, not getting a chapati for 2 days continuous. This means that was the only food at the time. And the only food that used to come to Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. This means that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam would probably eat wheat in one day, and the next day he would just suffice on dates. Wheat one day, barley one day, and the next day it would be dates. Hazrat Aisha says that there was not a single day in which Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and the family of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam fulfilled their stomachs to the need. They could not. There was no such day where they would eat to their full. This was the state of Rasulullah. With whatever came to him, he would give it back to the world. Whatever came to him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would give it back to the world. There was not a single day in which Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam would keep any wealth for himself. It is also narrated in Mishkat Sharif that once Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam got late for a prayer, the companions started wondering, where is Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam? Where has Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam gone? He's never late for salah. He's always on time. Then, after a short while, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam came upon them. And the companions started asking, they prayed salah. And the companions asked, Ya Rasulullah, you had come late today. Where were you? Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, I was coming for salah. And just then, a person came and he gave some gold to me. He gave some gold and I put it in my house. And as I was walking out, I couldn't bear that there should be gold in my house for just a moment. For just a moment. So I went to give sadaqah. I went to give it in charity. So this is why I got late for salah. Prayed it on time. But still he got late he came late to where the companions were waiting for him. Now there's many examples of the zuhud of Rasulullah. That Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam who spent the whole night in reading salah in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to such an extent that his feet would swell up. In such an extent that his feet would swell up. Now this is what we need to take upon, because we are ignorant of this. We think we can lead our lives in such a way, being happy and laughing and joking all the time, and forgetting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, it's good to have hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it's also good to cry in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also, and to shed tears in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like this night is a prime example for it. To seek the mercy and to seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to shed our tears in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to make and start swelling our feet in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now this is what Rasulullah, even though Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam does not do any sin, he was ma'soom, he neither had previous sins or no, he could sin, and he never will sin. But Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, regardless of this, did not need the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven him already. But rather, he would do this just for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through his zuhud, he would detach himself from the world, and just present himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's many examples. Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam once said that Hazrat Jibreel came, inna Jibreel la nazala alayhi, that Jibreel descended upon Rasulullah, that he said, inna Allah ta'ala yukri'uka salam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends peace upon you. Then Jibreel said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to you that, do you like that I make this mountain into gold? This mountain of Uhud, it was, that I make this mountain of Uhud into gold. Now what would happen? Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said that I do not want this. I do not want this. I just want to be an abdan shakura. I just want to be a slave who is thankful to his Lord. Whatever little he gets, I want to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. This was the zuhd of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam at that point answers to Jibreel. He says, Ya Jibreel, inna dunya daru man la dara lahu. That, oh Jibreel, this world, this destructible world, which is going to be destroyed, it is such a world, and it is for that person who has no house to live in. It is a temporary place which a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in. وَمَالُ مَنْ لَا مَالَ لَهُ. And it is the wealth of that person who has no wealth. Any wealth that we gain from this world, it is going to be destroyed in the hereafter. قَدْ يَجْمَعُهَا مَنْ لَا أَقْلَ لَهُ. And the person who has no intellect, who does not have a mind, he is the only one that accumulates this wealth. This is the zuhd, how he detached himself from the world. He would not even leave a single gold coin or a silver coin in his pocket. He would either give it to his wife or give it to any poor person. This was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'll end on one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which concludes the whole of the talk and the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is reported by Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, and he says that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said once that marifa, recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our wealth. Is our wealth. Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, wal aqlu aslu dini. And the intellect is the roots of my religion. It's the roots of my deen. Wal hubbu asasi. And love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the love of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is the foundations of me, of my religion. وَالشَّوْقُ مَرْقَبِي. And yearning for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my ride, is my vehicle towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَنِّيسِ. And the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my companion. وَالثِّقَةُ كَنْزِي. And trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my treasure. وَالْحُزْنُ رَفِيكِ. And grieving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my companion. وَالْعِلْمُ سِلَاحِ. And knowledge is my weapon which I use to do da'wah with. وَالصَّبْرُ رِدَائِ. And patience is my shawl. وَالْرِضَى غَنِيمَتِ. And the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my prize. وَالْعَجْزُ فَخْرِ. And me being weak in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being humble in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my pride. وَالزُّهْدُ حِرْفَتِ. And my detachment from this world for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my cloth, is my shawl. وَالْيَقِينُ قُوَّتِ. And certainty in and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is my strength. Now this was Rasulullah ta'ala. If we take any one of these things and believe in them firmly, then we can gain the love of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and gain the beautiful attributes of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now any one part of these, like Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam also says, وَالطَّاعَةُ حَسْبِي. Following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient for me. وَالْجِحَادُ خُلُقِي. And to do jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if it's with the tongue, is my characteristics. وَالْقُرَّةُ عَيْنِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ. And the coolness of my eyes is in salah. Is in reading namaz. It is obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by putting my forehead in front of him. If we take any one thing, especially the last one, to read our 5 times salah, then we are surely gaining the attributes of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. I had a lot to say, but alhamdulillah we finished out of time. If I get any other time to speak to you, inshallah I will on the same topic. Wa ma alayna al-bulagh. If you got any questions, you can ask them now. You asked the question that some people, like Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, that I am a human like you. Now I answered some of it in the talk itself, that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and most of the mufassireen in the ayah, I believe, I'm not hafiz, so I think it comes up, inna ma'ana basharun mislukum yuha ilayya. That Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, indeed, I am a human like you, and revelation comes to me. Now, most of the Mufassireen said that when Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, and in the hadith which I quoted in my talk, the Muhaddiseen have stated that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam has said this out of humbleness. And just by Qazi Ayyaz putting it in the chapter of humbleness shows that he took it as being that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said this out of modesty and humbleness. And the second answer is that Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam made a difference afterwards. Yuha ilayya, that I'm like you, but that's one thing. There be similarities, then there be differences. Okay, so we know Rasulullah ta'ala is different in how the revelation comes to him. Okay, it's such a rank which nobody can attain. Rasulullah ta'ala is that person who the Quran is revealed upon his heart. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if this Quran was revealed upon mountains, and then mountains will go into many pieces. Would scatter in many pieces. But Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam's heart is so strong that it could take the weight of the Quran. Now this is the difference. Okay? Now Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, I know the questions he didn't ask that, but Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is a human. Okay? And it's farz upon us to accept him as a human. But then there are ahadiths that show that he has another reality. He has another reality. Okay? Like Shaykh Ahmad Raza said, that it is farz upon us to accept. And any person who denies that Rasulullah ta'ala sallam is Bashar, he's out of the fold of Islam. Because the Quran testifies to this. But denying the realities of Rasulullah ta'ala sallam, that he's only a Bashar like us, then this is something which we cannot accept, them saying this. Why? Because there are many hadiths in abundance. Every book that you will open upon the hadith of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, you will realize Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam saying, I am not like you, I am not like you, I am not like you. Okay, I am not like you, Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam says. Okay, to Abu Bakr, okay, to the companions who started fasting like him, okay, fasting day and night, okay, till they came weak. And Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, perfect example, says, I am not like you, my Lord feeds me. That's another difference. So there are differences between us and Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah ta'ala has a different reality to us. Hope that answers the question.
Next question. A brother's asked, how can a person attain or gain love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam?
Firstly, following the commandments of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and the fundamentals of Islam. If you don't attain them, then it's false love. Okay? If a person cannot fulfill his five daily prayers, even if it's qaza, I'll say. Okay? First, do one time. Okay? But if you miss one salah, at least make up for it in the day. Okay? Once you've done that, then you can gain the love of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Read about Rasulullah. Okay? Get translations of Arabic books like Ash-Shifa. Okay? Read about them. They will create the love of Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam inside you. Okay? That's the best way I see. Okay, but the main thing is to act upon the religion of Islam. If you're leaving out the religion of Islam and not acting upon what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says and then proclaiming to love Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, then that love is false. It doesn't mean anything. Okay, because Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam wants you to act upon the religion. And like the usul is and the rule is that the lover will do anything for the person he loves. Okay, so Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is the one loved. And you are the lover. He wants you to accept Islam with your heart and have certainty upon Islam. Okay? And act upon every single thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says. Okay? That's when you'll gain the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Through your salah, through paying charity. Okay? Through respecting the ulama. You know, these little things will bring out the love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Next question is, besides the Hanafi school of thought, do the other three schools also send salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
It's the ijma of the ummah. Okay, but not just the ijma, it's a farz upon the ummah. Okay, and any person who denies sending salutations upon Rasulullah ta'ala alayhi wasallam to be haram or anything like that, I attain him to be out of the fold of Islam. Okay, so that's the ijma of the ummah, even though we got the Quran on it, okay, proving it to be farz. Okay, and the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yusalluna ala al-nabi. Okay, and further, sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. That's a command. Al-amru lil-wujub. Okay, that anything that comes in the command, it proves a farz and a wajib. Okay, and then secondly, is the ijma of the ummah. Every single imam of the Ahlul Sunnah is agreed that that sending salutation upon Rasulullah ta'ala is permissible. Okay? And any person who denies the ijma of the ummah is after the fall of Islam also.
JazakAllah. We've got another question here, which is slightly off topic. Before I ask that question, let me ask you, there was a documentary aired on BBC Two last week. Did you watch the documentary?
Yes.
Okay, I'll ask you the question. It says, what is the opinion of the majority of the scholars regarding the wahi which was mentioned in the recent documentary?
Yes, that was a funny one because a brother called Naveed asked me the same question recently. It was the time of Maghrib, wasn't it? Okay, that part came and I missed it, but I watched the replay. To my knowledge, and the best person to really ask was Mufti Saab, but to my knowledge, what happened was that as the scenario goes, that the Quraysh came to Rasulullah, and Rasulullah, a verse came and revelation came to Rasulullah, and saying that you can tell them to prostrate to their idols, okay, as I understood it, and I will carry on prostrating to my God, okay, allowing for Rasulullah, allowing them to prostrate to the idols. Okay, and then Rasulullah later on saying that they cannot do this. Okay, so what the Christians and the Jews and anyone not associated with Islam will try to say is that Rasulullah had an influence in the Quran. Okay, meaning that it was out of his own opinion. Okay, meaning that the Quran is false. Okay, astaghfirullah. Now here the answer to it is that Imam Tabari and Imam Waqidi narrated it in their history books. And the history books, like I told you about the Seerah is more concise and more, they concentrate on the narration itself if it's sahih, they authenticate it properly, okay? But in the history book, and these are Islamic history books, they just rampack them with anything, even if they're false. All they have to do is fill a gap in, even if it's true or false. And if you look at the narrations there, they are fabricated. Okay, and them two verses that the person in the documentary said, they do not exist in the Quran. Okay, I hope that answers the question. Okay, keep that in mind, they do not exist in the Quran. Okay, people might get you confused that saying that they're in the Quran, they're not in the Quran.
JazakAllah. We've got a question in regards to Shifa Sharif. A brother's asked, are you aware of the age of Qadi Ayyad when the book was published?
The biographies I looked at, it didn't actually say when the book was published itself. But it was in 64 years of his life.
JazakAllah, that's all we have. Thank you.